Good morning and welcome to members and members of the public to our 22nd meeting of the Devolution for the Powers Committee in 2015. It's normal at this point to remind members to switch off all their phones and electronic equipment, as sometimes that can interfere with the sound systems. Agenda item number one this morning is parliamentary oversight of intergovernmental relations. And we have a panel of academic witnesses with us this morning. I'm delighted that you're here. That we have Professor Nathalie Behnke from the University of Konstanz in Germany, Professor Bart Maddens, University of Leuven, in Belgium, and Dr. Sean Mueller, University of Berne, Switzerland, and Professor Julie Simmons, University of Guelph, Canada. Welcome to you all this morning. We haven't asked for any opening statements, and we have got a precious hour with you, so we're going to go now directly to the questions, and I'm going to try and open that up to you. You're all here because you're experts in intergovernmental relations in a variety of jurisdictions. To what extent in each of these countries do you consider that the legislators are effective in scrutinising intergovernmental relations? Starter for one. Who would like to take that? Professor Simmons.
Thank you. In Canada, we have a Westminster style parliamentary decision making at both the, we call it the federal, but the central level, and at the provincial level, or the subunits in the federation. And the discussions between the central government and the provincial governments, to the extent that they take place, are in extra parliamentary forums, so outside of either of the two legislatures, either at the central or at the provincial governments, and they involve exclusively the executive branch of government. So, for example, the premiers of the provinces would get together if they were invited by the Prime Minister and have a meeting. However, they have not had such a meeting since 2008. So the kind of decision-making that takes place is usually at the sectoral level. So all ministers of social services, for example, would get together among the provinces with their federal counterpart. But again, they are present at the meeting by virtue of the fact that they are the minister for that policy area and are a member of the executive in both in their respective legislatures.
Thank you. Anyone else?
I might continue giving evidence on Germany. We have traditionally very strong influence of the lender in federal decision making, and we have a fully fledged parliament in all 16 lender. However, I am not aware of any formal mechanism of parliamentary scrutiny on intergovernmental relations. They are generally regarded as exclusively executive. We have 18 ministerial councils on more or less every policy field where the lender ministers meet regularly on a regular basis between 2 and 4 times a year. And in most of those conferences, the federal ministers are involved. However, let me say two things. The one is, I think that our lender parliaments in a way misperceive their own role, because they try to do the same kind of politics that the federal parliament is doing, but due to the typical distribution of functions between the federal and the lender level, the lender need to care more about implementing laws. And so parliamentarians tend to neglect the administrative aspect of implementing laws. So they do not take enough interest in those intergovernmental agreements. Second point is, I think that in the parliamentary system, a lot of information goes through the party committees. So that, of course, those parties that hold the government, they would inform their party members in the parliament. But this is just, it's insufficient. So what would be really necessary would be a rule that results of intergovernmental meetings, of ministerial conferences, were at least made public on a regular basis. And I think that Parliament could profit either from a regulation that they directly got the results in form of a protocol or something, so that they just get informed about what was decided upon, or even better, if there was a regulation that results of ministerial conferences were made public, for example, on the websites of the conferences, so that even the wider public and the media were able to access those results, so there would be kind of a public debate and a better transparency and accountability of executive decision-making. However, one great advantage of those interministerial councils in Germany is that they are highly informal and that they are not open to the public, because it is a necessary precondition for land governments that they can informally, for example, change the position in negotiations without being held accountable for that from their parliaments. And I would not touch this vital advantage of informal networks and informal negotiations by requiring, for example, to make the meetings public. They are always closed from the public, and I think this is very important to make it work.
Good. Dr. Mueller.
Yeah, thank you, first of all, very much for the opportunity to be here. It's really a pleasure. The Swiss cantonal, the regional parliaments, they're not effective at all in overseeing intergovernmental relations, because it's considered to be a prerogative of the government. So they consider it to fall under foreign affairs, even if it's dealt with within Switzerland with other cantons, but another canton is like a different country in that sense. The reason for the lack of efficiency is that Swiss parliamentarians are no full-time politicians. They are part-time politicians, which means they extremely they lack resources, they lack the time to even fully deal with their own home rule legislation, let alone dealing with complex matters of intergovernmental relations. So they're quite happy that the government does the job. The second reason is that the parliaments themselves are not really important, because anyway, every important decision, every act of parliament or every act of the government is subject to a challenge through direct democracy. So if really there is something contentious, it will be voted upon and the people decide. So the parliaments don't really matter. The final point, there is one exception. The French-speaking cantons, the six French-speaking cantons of Switzerland, they have signed a special interparliamentary convention, which institutes a permanent interparliamentary body with six delegates from each of the six parliaments. And they meet three times a year, and they discuss amongst themselves, and they are there to monitor all the intergovernmental treaties and agreements that are being concluded by any of the six cantons.
Professor Maddens.
Thank you. Yes, first of all, I would like to emphasize that I am really honored to be invited by this prestigious parliament. In Belgium, intergovernmental relations are largely based on cooperation agreements between the various authorities. And these cooperation agreements, some of them are executive, other cooperation agreements are legislative and have to be agreed upon in Parliament. About half of the cooperation agreements have to be put before Parliament if they have legislative implications, if they have budgetary implications, or if they generate rights or obligations for the citizens. Now, in Parliament, both at the federal level or at the level of the member states, these cooperation agreements are dealt with in the same way as international treaties, which implies that they cannot be amended by Parliament. And Parliament either agrees or disagrees And I do not know any of any instances where parliaments have ever disagreed with these cooperation agreements. And yet, these cooperation agreements are very important because they limit the scope of legislative work afterwards. So the legislation has to be in conformity with these cooperation agreements. So in Belgium, this is generally considered as a kind of democratic deficit. The fact that the involvement of Parliament in the bringing about and the agreement on the cooperation agreements is actually very limited, and even if there is a if they have to be agreed upon in Parliament, there is very little discussion in Parliament. Also because these cooperation agreements deal with very, very technical matters. In the last reform of the state, which was agreed upon in 2011 and implemented in 2012-2013, a new device was introduced to kind of solve this democratic deficit. And that involves the possibility of voting common laws in the various parliaments. And so, for example, the Parliament of Flanders and the Parliament of Wallonia will be able to vote a common law, which implies that the same text will be voted in the Flemish Parliament and in the Walloon Parliament and will be prepared by an inter-parliamentary commission. So this is a new device, and we don't yet know to what extent this will be used, and this will help to solve this democratic deficit. But most institutionalists or constitutionalists fear that this will be a much too cumbersome procedure, and it will really come to nothing. It will be very exceptional, this procedure.
Given that we have, you know, a limited amount of time, I'm just going to open it up to questions now from committee members and ask for, you know, concise questions and concise answers, and we'll make some progress. Malcolm Chisholm, well, followed by Alec Johnson.
Yeah, I mean, I think you've probably covered up. I really want to ask you two questions. I think to some extent you've covered the first one, but I suppose in a kind of way from your first answers. Thank you, by the way, all of you, for very, very interesting and informative papers. Parliaments aren't coming out of this too well. It struck me when I read your papers, for example, I didn't know this, the Bundesrat is made up from Länder governments, not parliaments, and then Professor Simmons' paper highlighting the fact that it's bilateral meetings between executive branches that's almost the foundation of intergovernment relations. So, I mean, in a kind of way, you've covered that, but I mean, maybe I can roll it up in my second question and you can comment on either. The other area that there were lots of areas that interested me, but one thing that struck me was a reference in Professor Maddens' paper, where he quoted some research which said that in a normal federal system, statewide or federal parties constitute by far the most important element of linkage between the statewide and regional party systems. And I think you were saying that didn't happen in Belgium. It doesn't happen in the UK because the SNP is just a Scottish party. But just taking those two big ideas, to what extent are these party relations at different layers of government important in your country? And if you want to say any more about you know, the executive, I suppose crudely I've got those two ideas in my mind. We've got executives coming together in the different countries, and in some of the countries we've got parties kind of facilitating those intergovernment relations. So either or both of those two areas would be interesting for your comments. I'll just make it.
Who wants to respond first?
I think with regard to Belgium, it is important to make a distinction between various levels. I referred to the level of the cooperation agreements earlier. This is like the oil which makes the mechanism function. But this at this level, the very technical conflicts or disputes are settled. But then there is the political level, where we also have various cooperation devices, the most important of which is the Federal Consultation Committee, in which the prime ministers of the federal level and of the federation and the various member states meet. And while it appears to be, it appears that the administrative level, the level of the cooperation agreements, this is largely functioning. When an issue is actually being politicized, it is raised to the level of the political decision-making, to the level of the consultation committee, and then it is actually very difficult to reach a solution. And that is related to the problem of the split political parties in Belgium and of the asymmetry between the various coalitions. For example, right now we have a center-right coalition at the federal level, but we have a central also at the Flemish level, but we have a center-left coalition at the level of the Walloon region and the Francophone community. So there is no party at the Francophone side which is part of both the federal coalition and the regional coalition. And this is actually the first time that this is the case in the history of Belgian federalism. And this makes it very difficult to reach a solution in the consultation committee. And so what the consultation committee actually does, if there is a politicized conflict, is noticing that there is a conflict and that there are different points of views from the different member states or the different levels.
I think we could focus on that issue about conflict resolution later. I think there's some questions in that. Does anyone else want to respond to Malcolm's question? Professor Simmons?
In Canada, the party system isn't a federated system. So, in other words, there is a conservative party at the national level, but it does not have any formal ties with any of the right-wing parties at any within any of the provinces. And sometimes the provinces have a different name for their conservative party to make things confusing. So, for example, British Columbia's conservative party is called the Liberal Party, which is the central party at the national level. And in the conservative party in Saskatchewan is called the Saskatchewan Party. It's called the Wild Rose Party in Alberta. So there is no formal ties except for in the New Democratic Party, which is the most sort of left-wing party active in the parliaments at both the federal and provincial levels. And they do have a federated system. But because the New Democratic Party has never formed yet the government at the national level, maybe in a couple weeks, because they haven't yet formed the government at the national level, we haven't been able to see a lot of cross-pollination between, say, ministers who have held portfolios at a provincial level, been involved in the legislatures there, and then moving into the national forum, which I think is a very healthy thing when that can exist as one way of encouraging politicians at either level to kind of be thinking about the other order of government. So, in other words, if you're a provincial politician, thinking about things in national terms sometimes is good, not necessarily always thinking about things in terms of protecting the turf of the province. And likewise, as a federal politician, being able to think about things from the perspective of individual provinces or nations or what have you within the broader state. So,
anyone else? Professor Behnke.
Thank you. I totally agree to your diagnosis, Mr. Thomson, and I just want to emphasize the importance of networks in German intergovernmental relations. And those networks are indeed a mix of party political and bureaucratic. So what is a very important informal institution in Germany is we have telephone, weekly telephone conferences among ministerial bureaucrats of the Länder ministries and state chancelleries, but They are like two overlapping networks, and one is the A round and the other is the B round, from lender governed mainly by social democratic parties on the one hand side, lender governed mainly by Christian democratic parties on the other hand side. So this is a very strong and powerful informal network which operates through those telephone conferences and which operates also through informal meetings in Berlin, where ministerial bureaucrats are sent from the lender to the lender representations. They work in Berlin, and they go to factional committees in the federal parliament, for example. So there is a land governed by the Christian Democrats. They send a ministerial bureaucrat to Berlin, and he goes to a meeting of his policy field of a committee, of a party committee in the federal parliament. So there's a very, very close interconnection, and this is where information flows move. And I know this is very unpleasant to say, but the lender parliaments play a close to an important role in those networks. So information really goes between ministerial bureaucrats and the policy experts in the parties, which is facilitated by the fact that we have a strongly vertically integrated party system. So we have the same parties at the lender level and at the federal level.
Dr. Miller, do you wish to comment?
Just to make the point that the Swiss case is the exact opposite of Belgium in that regard, because all the parties, or all the major parties that are in power at the federal level at the moment, there are five parties in power. They're also more or less in power in any of the 26 cantons, because there are so many parties, it's a multi-party system, and there's so many veto channels that it's just impossible to have a Westminster-type government opposition, because the opposition has so much power that it's better to include it in the government so it doesn't take up the veto through direct democratic challenge. The second point is, of course, there is one exception. The canton of Ticino, which is the only Italian-speaking canton of Switzerland, has its own regionalist party, the Lega dei Ticinesi, that's a league for the Ticino inhabitants, and it really started to take off in the last 20 years on an agenda of, we are different, we don't want secession, we don't want independence, because they're very small and they could only go to Italy. Nobody wants to go to Italy. So, in fact, what they would like is more federal involvement in regional affairs, more subsidies, more protection, and also to be out of the European Union. But that's the only case of this disintegration of the party system. Otherwise, party channels are very important, like in Germany, for transmitting the information in both directions.
We need to move our canter now. I suppose Alec Johnson, followed by Tavish.
The parliamentary scrutiny of intergovernmental relations is a rare beast, but where it is achieved is easier to achieve where there's a formal institutionalised structure. Now, given that, I see you all nodding, the simple question is that we are observing what's happened in other countries, and it seems to be that it has evolved over time. It has reacted to demands at different times, and structures are very much specialised for the areas that they're in. We have a chance to look at it from an evolutionary structure and try to put parliamentary scrutiny into the structure at an early stage. If you had a blank slate in your various countries, what would you do differently? What should we be doing to institutionalise parliamentary scrutiny of intergovernmental relations?
I would just make two points. The first is, indeed, I would give a kind of legal foundation to inter-ministerial councils. This would help to oblige them to meet on a regular basis and would not make meetings dependent, for example, on the will of the Prime Minister. In Germany, this is not necessary because we have the habit of doing it. But if you want to establish a habit of doing it, it is certainly helpful to have a legal foundation. And the second point is, I would add in this legal foundation an obligation to make results of the negotiations public. This is very important. This is something that I'm really unhappy about, the German system, because it's so informal that you just don't get the results. We as researchers don't get them, and the parliaments don't get them either. So at least a provision saying, okay, we get a protocol of the results of each meeting, and this is given to the information of parliament. That's it.
Is it agreed that those principles are important, or from your experience? Is there anyone else wants to add any one or two points to that, or do they generally agree? Professor Maddens.
My impression on the basis of the Belgian case is that at the technical level, institutionalization is not so important. I think the technicians, the civil servants, the cabinet members will find a way to solve technical matters. We have a huge number of institutional devices in Belgium to facilitate cooperation, but my impression is that these are not so important. And so they will find, even if they wouldn't exist, they would find a way via ad hoc regulations to solve issues. On the other hand, when issues become politicized, then it's already too late. Then the institutions will not help either, because it becomes a political issue, and whether you have these devices or not, it doesn't make such a big difference. But there is one thing I should add. I have talked about these various layers, the more executive, administrative layer of cooperative agreements, the political layer, which very exceptionally is able to solve political issues. But then we have another layer in Belgium which is becoming increasingly important, and that is the Constitutional Court. The Constitutional Court is increasingly becoming a very, very important player to solve political disputes. If there is a dispute according to who is competent for a certain matter. If, for instance, we had a dispute in Belgium with regard to foreign trade, which is a matter, a competence of the regions, yet there was still interference of the federal Ministry of Foreign Affairs in foreign trade policy. So this was a big issue in Belgium, political dispute, and this was a couple of months ago finally settled by the Constitutional Court. The powers of the Constitutional Court have also been increased through the last reform of the state, and the Constitutional Court will now also be able to check whether the legislation is in conformity with the constitutional principle of federal loyalty, and the Constitutional Court has the power to abrogate laws. In a recent column, I have raised this issue, and I have said, actually, the Constitutional Court is the most powerful parliament in Belgium. It is not directly elected. In a way, it is indirectly elected, because the members are appointed by the federal parliament. But it is actually the final stage of the legislative process. If a law is voted in Parliament, then everybody, let's say, waits and sees what the Constitutional Court will say in the end. Obviously, before the Constitutional Court can scrutinize a law, somebody has to put it before the Constitutional Court. But that is increasingly the case, because there are, for any, if a law is a little bit controversial, then somebody will put the case before the Constitutional Court.
We, I think all of us sitting around this table, might see routine recourse to the courts in some form as a horrifying prospect. Are you recommending it?
No, because what if? I think the Spanish case is very interesting in that respect. You have the Tribunal Constitucional in Spain, which plays the same role as the Constitutional Court in Belgium, which is also consists of politically appointed judges. But its role has become increasingly controversial. That's one of the reasons why the independentists in Catalonia have so much support and might even win the quasi-referendum on the 27th of September, because they argue that the Constitutional Court is actually a politicized organ and is composed of Spanish-minded judges who actually abrogate most of the laws which the Catalonian Parliament votes. So this is a risk that the Constitutional Court, if it is obliged to become a political player will become politicized. And then obviously the major issue is who appoints the judges in this constitutional court, and to what extent is this transparent? In the United States, this is very transparent. There are hearings.
We've got that point. We've got, you know, if we don't cooperate and if we don't set up some, you know, trustful relationships, this where we might end. Tavi Scott, please.
And then you very much like your constitutional principle of federal loyalty. That sounds something we should come back to in this country. I actually wanted to ask the German experience in terms of a practical issue. Obviously, your country is dealing with the refugee crisis in a very public way, and you're to be applauded for that. Was the federal government's decision to encourage so many people from Syria to come to Germany discussed previously through the mechanisms you described with the Länder? So it's just been...
No, there was no time. There was simply no time. We had a public discussion trying to figure out why and how Angela Merkel came to this decision. I feel it was a typical instance of Chancellor prerogative, and she decided quite autonomously. Mm-hmm. But what happened was a discussion afterwards, because the Länder now come and say, well, okay, this is your decision, but we have to handle it. So we need the money and we need the facilities. And so after this decision, now the typical intergovernmental mechanisms start working. Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's very helpful. And I can very much understand that. The other question I wanted to ask was of the Canadian experience, because obviously it's, as you rightly said, Professor Simmons, much more akin to it is a Westminster system in that sense. Do you have a perspective on the point that Alec Johnson was asking about as to whether intergovernmental relations should be backed by some kind of statute, by law, or would that make any difference to the way your prime ministers, as you were describing, basically not met the provincial leaders, premiers, since, I can't remember, you said 12 years or so?
2008. Yes. So in Canada, for some time throughout history, since about the 1960s, the provinces, the leaders of each of the provinces, the premiers, meet on an annual basis. And they have, from time to time over that period, called for regularized meetings with the Prime Minister. And the latest kind of iteration of that was in discussions in about 2003. They were trying to create a new institution that might indeed involve the Prime Minister. And in fact, this was spearheaded by Quebec. Quebec wanted to have regular institutionalized intergovernmental forum where leaders met, and ultimately the other premiers would only agree to that institutionalized forum if they didn't want to extend the invitation to the federal government.
Was there any parliamentary scrutiny, or was there any discussion of parliamentary scrutiny of that process when those discussions took place?
There wasn't, although the discussions were at the executive level, so I'm not privy to those discussions.
Yeah, exactly. But the parliaments, whether in Quebec or in Vancouver, didn't kick up and say, wait a minute, we've got to have a role in that?
No, but it's because... That would have been a monumental change had it come about. And so the prospect of bringing parliaments into the discussion would probably be a second monumental change. Yeah.
I wasn't arguing fairness, there should be in the discussion. It was more the monitoring of what's happening akin to the points that your colleagues
yes.
have been making.
Yeah, yeah. No, there was
not notice. No. Okay.
To my knowledge, no.
Thank you.
Linda.
Yeah. That was all really interesting, and it leads on to what I wanted to bring up. And it relates back to last night's roundtable discussion that we had. And it was Professor Guy Laforêt who said that to make intergovernmental relations and parliamentary relations and inclusion in that work, you really had to challenge the historical hierarchies. And I thought that was a really interesting comment to make. And we could well be in a privileged position in that we're sort of starting this off rather than where your respective legislators are. But we do have historical hierarchies of all sorts within the British system. Another participant had talked about strengthening the relationships amongst the devolved institutions, and Professor Mueller, you raised that today as well as part of your contribution. So I would like your opinions on how you challenge the historical hierarchies, and what do you see as strengthening the relationships amongst the devolved institutions, and how can that be used to challenge these hierarchies? Because within the settlement we have in the UK at the moment, there's the British Irish Council, but beyond that, there's nothing except very informal meetings, like Professor Behnke mentioned, around about the joint ministerial committees that sometimes meet.
Maybe I just pick up on that first, if I may. Because you're right that this is a particular feature of Swiss federalism that these, I mean, to begin with, the hierarchy in Switzerland is the other way around. It's the cantons that call the shots and the national government that is weaker in that sense, has less money, has less power than the bottom level. So maybe most interesting in your case would be the fact or the insight that coalitions can be issue-specific and can be of variable geometry. So I give you an example. For example, fiscal equalization. The rich regions pay the poor regions. In Switzerland currently there are 9 rich regions and 17 poor regions. The way this came about was that the poor regions got together beforehand and they came to an agreement that this is the way the system should work and let's do this formula so we have more winners than losers, with the result that in a popular vote, obviously the majority had won, so there you go. Now, the interesting fact is that the rich regions are not only the German or French-speaking or the mountain or the rural areas. They're all over the place. So on the issue of fiscal equalization, the alliance between the winners in that case is different than, say, on education policy, where there are other interests, than, say, on rural or urban planning, where there are other alliances. So my advice, if I can be so frank, would be to seek for issue-specific coalitions with other players involved in the British system. So why not, and it was mentioned yesterday, team up with the City of London if it's about developing economic development? Why not team up with local governments in other areas? It doesn't always have to be Wales or Northern Ireland that you have to be in bed, so to speak.
That's interesting.
Well, a crucial characteristic of Belgian federalism is that in principle there is no hierarchy between the various levels. So there is the allocation of competences is based on the principle of exclusivity. Either one level is competent or the other, and if one level is competent, it has full legislative powers. And so the federal government or the federal level cannot substitute the sub-state levels. But there is one important caveat, and I think this is something which should be raised here also, that is the impact of the European Union. So what we see in Belgium is that in areas which are completely devolved, for example, agriculture, the federal government has almost no competence in the field of agriculture. But agriculture, the European Union has an important competence on agriculture. And because of that, the federal level, even though it is formally not competent, and is not, as I said, hierarchically higher than the regions, but it remains a crucial player because it acts as a linkage to the European Union level, and it coordinates the points of view of the various regions, and it facilitates the coming about of a Belgian point of view for the European Council of Ministers. And so in the European Council of Ministers, Belgium has only one single unitary vote. It cannot split up its vote. And so either the regions reach an agreement about that vote, or if they do not reach an agreement, they have to abstain, and they lose their impact on the decision-making in the Council of Ministers. And they always reach an agreement. There's only one example of a case in which there was no agreement amongst the regions. And as I said, this is coordinated by the Federal Ministry of Foreign Affairs. So this is actually something which you have to keep in mind, even for fully devolved matters, the federal level remains a crucial player because of the Europeanization.
Professor Simmons.
Yeah, I think, Ms. Fabiani, this is a really tough question that you have been asking. Thinking in terms of hierarchy, there are three issues that came to my mind. The first is money. For example, in Germany, the lender are historically older than the federal level, and they have a very independent basis of existence. However, the federal level gets the lion's share of joint taxes, so it is always in a stronger position to influence policies. If you really try to get to this hierarchy issue, Scotland must get an independent base of funding. I've been talking about this yesterday. I don't know which is the best way, either tax autonomy or fixed share of shared taxes, but this must is a first step to get kind of independent leeway of action. The second is if you think in terms of federal architecture, as far as I can see, negotiations take mostly place bilaterally between Scotland and the UK level. As Sean Mueller said before, one step to empower the regional level might be to strengthen horizontal linkages, either issue-specific or in a general level, so that you would have a multilateral negotiation arena of all regionalized territories negotiating with a UK level. Of course, this is very complicated because of the England issue, because of the lopsided architecture. So this is nothing that you can solve today, but you must just keep it in mind. And the third aspect is autonomy is helpful, but co-decision is very valuable as well. So you must be very careful in deciding which areas you claim more autonomy on decision making, and in which areas you might try to claim co-decision rights, in which way ever. I mean, we are very privileged with the Bundesrat. It is a very strong institution securing co-decision rights, but you might think about establishing veto rights or committees or whatever, so that in those matters that are really important to Scotland, you try to get more co-decision. So these would be three aspects. I mean, they are all very hard to get, but to think about cracking this hierarchy.
So much.
My list was similar, so I won't go over the same issues. But I did want to say that in Canada, the key terrain for hierarchy is finances, and so. My advice would be that if you have particular areas of jurisdiction that you are responsible for, you need to ensure that either you have full control of the money to fund those things, or you have full control over the formula by which that money is shared. Not full control, but shared control. And that whatever money does come is unconditional. Right, so that there are not strings attached, because in the federal government in Canada or in Canada's history, the federal government has played a very big role in areas of provincial jurisdiction by creating conditions on grants that it gives to the provinces, and over time they've become more and more and more unconditional. So it's a very small percentage. I think I said in the written information that I shared that it was around 25% of the funding that provinces get from the federal government is conditional. The rest of it is unconditional. But only about 15% of provinces' money comes from the federal government. They have their own taxing powers. But even amidst all of that, it's still a hierarchy. So, and that's because of the they need to have more horizontal decision making, as Nathalie was saying, that so that the provinces come together, and the strategy has been so that they can have a counter legitimacy to claim to speak on behalf of the country as a whole. So the federal government can't claim to know what's best for the interests of Canadians exclusively when the premiers can come together and say, well, we have come together and we have come to these agreements and we represent Canadians too.
Thank you. Mark McDonald?
Yeah, it goes back slightly, and during the answers to Alec Johnson and Tavish Scott, there was some discussion around the sort of legal basis for intergovernmental relations. One of the things that struck me is that where we have a difference here is in terms of the absence of a written constitution. And obviously the supremacy of Westminster means that the legislation at Westminster is not able to be challenged in the way that, for example, it would be in a constitutional court scenario. So I guess the question I would pose would be, does that present a difficulty here in terms of embedding intergovernmental relations in statute, and also how effective has that proven to be in those places where it is embedded in statute, both in terms of the processes but also in terms of the outcomes? Who wants to kick off?
That in Canada it's not embedded in statute. Any intergovernmental forums are not recognized constitutionally, and parliamentary sovereignty always can trump any intergovernmental decision. So even if premiers and the prime minister, or let's say ministers of social services, were to get together and agree on something, as they did say in 2005 on the issue of childcare funding, the next prime minister that is voted in was Stephen Harper, and he chose to unilaterally cancel every childcare agreement with every province. So it would not be one that I would suggest that you emulate.
Although similarly, because we have a system here where no parliament can legally bind its successor, even if it were placed in statute, there would be nothing to stop a similar scenario mm-hmm. from arising mm-hmm. in a future Westminster government.
Thank you. I don't see a real problem in you not having a written constitution. If I look at Germany, those things are mostly not written into the constitution. They are on regular statutory basis, if at all. So, of course, you are right, statutes can be changed, but they also develop a certain continuity and power if they work. And I would recommend really to put this on a statutory footing, simply because of thinking if you want to establish new routines, if you want to empower groups that have recently been weak, then it helps to give a statutory footing. This may be misplaced, but I was thinking of the analogy of the gender quota in Germany. And you may be against it because you say, well, this is something against democratic principles, whatever. But it helps establishing certain routines. And after a while, when things are working, you can get back from the statutory footing and it still works. So I would definitely recommend it as a starting.
Any other responses?
In Belgium, we have the constitution, but the details of the institutional structure are written down in special laws, which is a kind of quasi-constitution. And all the arrangements for cooperation are written down in these special laws. But in my view, the most important implication of, you already said it, that of us having a constitution and of these special laws being based on constitutional principles is the constitutional court, because the constitutional court checks whether the laws are in conformity with the constitution. And if you don't have a constitution, it's difficult to see how you would have a constitutional court, obviously.
Okay, Rob Gibson, please.
Thank you very much. Good morning. We have had a proposal. We're thinking about financial equalisation between
sub-state and state. In the proposals for the Scotland Bill, the new devolution proposals in the UK are expected to be accompanied by a no-detriment principle. This means two things. Neither the UK nor the Scottish Government should face a detrimental revenue or spending impact by the decision to transfer new powers at the point of devolution. And I think we understand what that's about. But neither the UK nor the Scottish Government should face a detrimental revenue or spending impact as a direct result of the policy decisions of the other government. If one government is adversely affected financially by the policy decisions of the other, the no detriment principle suggests that the offending government should compensate them financially. No one seems to understand this, you know, but from the countries that you study or are familiar with, can you point to any similar compensatory mechanism that resembles this no detriment principle?
The major Swiss reform of Swiss federalism was built on this principle. So what happened in 2004, or it took 25 years to implement the reform, but when it finally entered into force, then the principle was this. Divisions are reallocated between the national and the regional level. Some competences become national, some become regional. So it's a kind of devolution, but it goes both ways. But every competence was exactly monetarized. So the costs of every policy shift was indexed, and the tax sharing was adjusted accordingly. So in the balance of things, the regional levels got more power and they also got more money to pay for those competences. But I'm not aware of any ongoing embedding of this principle. That was just a one-off as part of a wider reform.
Well, yes, in Belgium it's actually quite similar. Whenever a competence is devolved, the budget is also devolved, and the regions or the communities obtain the means to execute this competence. But in the latest reform of the state, the sixth reform of the state, it was a way to economize on the federal level, and they only devolved 90% of the means to execute the competence, which was actually a way to force the member states to economize themselves, because that's one of the main political issues currently in Belgium, that the federal government, which is not hierarchically superior, cannot oblige the member states to economize. This trick by only transferring 90% of the means was actually a way to oblige the regions and the communities to economize.
Professor Becker.
Yes. One founding principle of the German fiscal constitution is the principle of connectivity. And it means that the level that is responsible for a task is also responsible for financing the task. So any time that a new task is decided upon or emerges or whatever, or changes levels of government, there is a negotiation on how to finance it. What we do is we do not set those mostly in statute, or we do not devolve tax autonomies. That we renegotiate mostly the VAT shares. So this is the large sum of money where the lender in the Bundesrat, they come and say, okay, if we have to pay for whole day childcare, and this is in our competence, so the connectivity principle requires that we pay for it. We do not have the power to levy new taxes, but if you give us 1 percentage point more of the VAT, we can take this money and finance the whole day childcare, for example. So the VAT share between the federal and the lender level is the major negotiation pool for adjusting the finances and the tasks.
So the spillover mechanisms are actually worked out on the basis of agreement.
Yeah, it's always negotiated.
And there, not only that, it seems as though that in the first instance, there's an agreement that the devolved subjects will have particular powers.
Yeah. Yes, we don't. have anything like what you described initially in Canada, but there are tax harmonization agreements between the provinces and the federal government in terms of what percentage of corporate tax and what percentage of personal income tax will be automatically given to the provinces. Basically, it's collected by the federal government, but then these harmonization agreements govern the percentage of those that would go to the provinces. Over time, provinces also have introduced their own sales taxes, so the equivalent of the value-added taxes here, as a way of also creating revenue, and the federal government has a value-added tax as well. But by and large, over time, more of the percentage of personal income tax and corporate tax has moved from the federal government to the provinces. It is not something that there's a lot of transparency around, though, although there are specific agreements in place, and you would want to speak to an economist about the ins and outs of what those look like.
Stuart McMillan.
So the first question is to Professor Behnke, just regarding your comments a moment ago on the connectivity principle. If in a lend that they have the powers to undertake a particular policy direction, and they also have the finance, do they then have to communicate that to the Bundestag and to the other lender? In terms of what they're doing and why they want to do it.
You mean if one land autonomously decides to introduce a new policy and to spend money for it?
Yes.
Well, basically, this is in their own right. The money that is distributed between levels and among the lender is based on a logic of equalizing fiscal capacity and is not based on specific spending on specific policies. For example, we have in Rheinland-Pfalz, in one of the länder, they have the policy that childcare places do not cost anything, so that parents can give their kids to childcare and they don't have to pay, whereas in all the other lender, parents have to pay for childcare. This is something that land can decide completely autonomously because they have their income, their revenues, and they have the right to have fiscal equalization based on fiscal capacity. However, how they spend their money is completely in their own right. What happens nonetheless is in those informal circles that things are being communicated. So they just inform each other based on an idea of generating best practices or something like that. But there's no formal necessity. The other way around, however, is if the federal level decides on a policy which affects the lender in terms of personnel or new tasks or finances, then it automatically becomes an issue that must be approved in the second chamber in the Bundesrat. So this is the really strong position of the lender, because once they have to approve to getting new tasks, they can at the same time negotiate on the financing.
So you mentioned in your paper the situation regarding the Bundesrat. And you mentioned that the issue of the self-rule and the trading the self-rule and also the trading of self-rule or self-government for shared rule. And do you think that trade-off is necessary? or do you think that you can actually have both shared rule and also the self-rule?
Okay. Of course, we have both. And the tendency to trade rights of self-rule against rights of shared rule is owed to the great disparity of fiscal capacity among the lender. Personally, I do not approve of this tendency, but I can understand that those lender who do not have a lot of own resources because they have a weak economy and they get only a small share of income tax and corporate tax, they of course, prefer to have the federal level finance or co-finance a lot of tasks because they just cannot afford on their own. The rich lender, however, they have more fiscal resources and they could do it on their own. So there is a conflict of interest among the lender. And in its tendency in the past years, you can observe that the majority of lenders prefer it to giving tasks back to the federal level and getting rights of co-decision and getting co-financing by the federal level.
If there's no other member wishing to ask a question at this point, yeah, of course you can.
That's why it's more supplementary, because I'm not sure I'm clear on this no detriment principle that is supposed to be getting introduced here, and your answers on that issue. Because as I understand, my understanding at the moment of what's supposed to be going to happen here is that if one part of the UK, for Scotland for example, implements a policy which negatively impacts on another part, then effectively we would have to compensate that part of the UK, or vice versa. Does that happen anywhere else? Or it seemed to be the case that you were saying effectively, if a lender or a state or had the rights and had the money, it could carry out a policy, irrespective of its impact on the surrounding states or cantors or lenders. Is that correct?
I think it depends. Well, it depends on the area. In general, you're right that the regions in Switzerland are completely autonomous, and actually the very idea of federalism is to have this competition. So you want that regions, for example, lower their levels in education so they attract the people that don't need public but can afford private education. And this, by definition, has to have a detrimental impact on the other regions. So you want this competition, so you should not compensate. On the other hand, there is the idea that for major spillover effects, cantons should get together and compensate each other. But it's up to the cantons if they actually do it.
Yes. Well, in Belgium, we have a special mechanism, which is called conflicts of interest. So if the policy of one region has a detrimental impact on the federal level or on another region, the other region can invoke a conflict of interest. And then this is decided in the consultation committee, which I referred to earlier. And this is very closely related to the notion of federal loyalty, which is written down in the Constitution. And we make this important distinction between conflicts of competence and conflict of interest. So a region may remain formally within its competence, but still harm the interests of the other region. But there is a tendency in Belgium that this distinction between conflicts of interest, which is essentially a political issue, and conflicts of competence, which is a formal legal issue, this distinction has become blurred. And there is a tendency, again, in the Constitutional Court to also check conflicts of interests. This is also related to the extended competences of the Constitutional Court. And the Constitutional Court more and more applies the principle of proportionality. So a level should execute its own competence in such a way that it does not disproportionately limit the possibilities of the other levels to execute their own competences. And in this way, this distinction between conflicts of interest and conflicts of competence has become more or less blurred. I don't know if this is more or less clear. It's a difficult issue in Belgian constitutional law.
It sounds it.
Just one additional comment. I think perhaps it's helpful to distinguish between a logic of curing negative consequences or preventing them. So the no detriment clause, as I understand it, is an ex post clause. So after an action has taken place, then something must happen to compensate. And instead, in Germany, the logic of cooperative federalism is trying to avoid actions that are to the detriment of others. So they negotiate in advance, and so there's no kind of formula to compensate afterwards.
But this is also the case in Belgium. We also have all kinds of preventive institutional measures to prevent conflicts of interest. So the various levels have to inform one another, have to collect the advice of the other levels. But this is, in Belgium, largely a matter of formalities. It does not really play an important role. And so all the government just makes sure that it abides by these formal requirements, that it informs the other levels, but it doesn't really have an impact. So it's really the curative devices are much more important in Belgium than the preventive ones.
Thanks for that. Thank you. I've one final question. I know I'm pushing it because we are in time, but the, you know, right at the beginning, you all said that parliaments around the world had generally very weak and not involved in scrutiny of intergovernmental relations. And just setting you up for the next panel, and see your witnesses there in the public gallery. The next panel is the two most senior civil servants responsible for intergovernmental reform. Should their review change that situation about parliaments and scrutiny? Should their review ensure that we don't make the mistakes that others have made with the absence of parliamentary scrutiny and intergovernmental relations?
I can just ask, should their review of what?
The review of the memorandum of understanding, they're reviewing the whole process mm-hmm. of intergovernmental relations. We'll be asking them probably in the next session, looking towards them, as how do we consider Parliament's role, Parliament, the role of committees in that scrutiny of intergovernmental relations? How would Parliament play a role in that? You have suggested earlier, all of you, mm-hmm. that parliaments and their committees and all the structures are either weak or don't play a role in that at all. Should their review seek to make it different here in our relations? Dr. Mueller.
Well, I guess that's up to you for yourself to decide. I mean, it's not up to us to say what you should do, what kind of structures you should implement. It's an academic debate whether it's good to have parliamentary involvement in international or intergovernmental relations. I'm also not sure that having meetings public would help finding agreements. There is a whole literature that says it's helpful to have meetings in secret because people can be more open and can see compromise. So it's a political question, and you're the politicians. I think you should answer it.
That wasn't as helpful as I had hoped it would be. Professor Martin.
As a political scientist, I'm actually quite pessimistic about that. Because of all kinds of factors, the impact of parliaments is decreasing. And it is largely a theatre. I know that Jeremy Corbyn wants to make it less of a theater, as he said yesterday, but it is really a theater. And at least in Belgium, parliaments have a minimal impact on policy making. Another aspect is the Europeanization. You see that also at the European level, they try to cope with this problem. For instance, through the early warning procedure in the Treaty of Lisbon. But this has very, at least in Belgium, this has very little impact. Parliaments try to grasp what's going on at the European level, but they do not have the expertise, they do not have the personnel. It is so complex, so technical, that the involvement of politicians in Parliament is doomed to be marginal.
Oh, stop. Professor Behnke, I can't tempt you into this. You have made some comments earlier, I suppose.
Yeah, I think I've said everything on that.
On that pessimistic note from Professor Maddens, thank you very, very much for your attendance here this morning. Your engagement last night, those of us who were able to attend enjoyed that, when many of your colleagues were there here in the Parliament. That informal engagement was appreciated, and all of the time that you've given us here this morning. Thank you very, very much indeed. We're going to pause at this point until we clear our witnesses and set up our next panel. Thank you very much. We now return to agenda item number 2 on our agenda today, which of course is taking further evidence on the wider reform of intergovernmental relations from the UK and Scottish officials. And we have with us this morning Philip Rycroft, head of the UK Governance Group, Cabinet Office, UK Government, and Ken Thomson, Director General Strategy and External Affairs from the Scottish Government. Welcome to you both, gentlemen. There is no opening statements, and in the interest of time, we'll press on and open up with the first question to Mr. Rycroft. You are, of course, the UK Government's lead official responsible for the review of the Memorandum of Understanding and the apparatus of joint ministerial committees. It might be helpful to us this morning if you could outline why the review was set up in the background, what the terms of reference are for that review, and how, indeed, the review is progressing.
Thank you, Convener. All good questions. So, obviously, we've had a system of intergovernmental relations in place since devolution in 1999, with JMC machinery supported by the MOU, and in fact, quite a complex set of concordats and MOUs covering a number of different parts of business. That has served its purpose, and in some views has served its purpose well over the years. But clearly we're coming to a major juncture in the devolution settlements. There are proposals before the Westminster Parliament at the moment for further devolution for Scotland, a commitment from the UK government for further devolution to Wales and a significant change in the Welsh settlement. And obviously following the Stormont House Agreement, changes also in the Northern Ireland settlement. So the devolution settlements are changing. The JMC plenary that met, chaired by the Prime Minister with the First Ministers and Deputy First Minister of the Northern Ireland Assembly in attendance last year, agreed, as they always do by consensus, that this was an appropriate moment to review the machinery of the JMC and the associated MOU. So that was the remit we were given, and that remit was passed to Ken, myself and our colleagues from the Welsh Government and Northern Ireland Executive, and that's the remit we're taking forward. So it is a very broad terms of reference. We're not confined, if you like, by what we consider in that space. And the way that we've taken that forward hitherto is through a series of meetings that we've held at official level. As it happens, the latest one was just yesterday, where we covered this territory again. And at some point in the next few weeks, we're going to obviously have to consult our own ministers on the way forward with this, ultimately looking for ministerial agreements on this, hopefully before the end of the year at the JMC plenary. So I hope that gives you a brief overview of where we're at. Interesting process, but it does mark, and I think this is recognised by all the administrations, moments of change in the devolution settlements, and a very appropriate moment, therefore, to review how the intergovernmental machinery works.
You know, in that broad remit that you do have you given any consideration about how you would inform parliaments on its committees about the depth of work that you're engaged in, the volume of work that you're engaged in, or indeed who you're engaging with, outside, you know, ministerial officials, etc., or experts?
So if I answer that question in a sort of general terms about what people see and understand about what's going on in the intergovernmental relations space, I think it's probably true to say that parliamentary scrutiny across the piece has been relatively light over the past few years. I suspect that will change, certainly from my perspective, working in the Whitehall context. A lot of interest in this, for example, from the House of Lords Constitution Committee and from the Political and Constitutional Reform Committee in the House of Commons. So I anticipate that we will be facing increased scrutiny on intergovernmental relations in the months and years ahead. Clearly, it's a matter, as some of your previous speakers have said, it's a matter for the parliaments themselves, how they hold their executives to account in this space. But one of the things I think we do need to think about is in order for effective scrutiny to take place, parliaments need to understand, as indeed does the wider public, what is happening in intergovernmental space. And it's maybe worth making the point at this stage in our discussion is that the JMC itself sits at the apex of a whole complex of intergovernmental working. And that intergovernmental working in 101 different aspects and dimensions is actually absolutely critical to the good governance of the United Kingdom as a whole. And you know, day-to-day contact between the devolved administrations and UK government and between themselves to ensure that that business policies can be taken forward effectively. So I think there is advantage, clearly, in people understanding the depth and the range of that interaction between the governments and how that supports the good government governance of the United Kingdom. And so one of the things that we will have to look at is how do we make that real? What is the appropriate level of information and transparency around dealings within intergovernmental relations space? And that's one of the things we'll be looking at, but clearly, ultimately, it will be for the ministers of all four administrations to decide how they express that and what agreement they reach on that when they look at this in the round.
But do you believe in that process that you've met your objective and of you know both governments need to work together to create a more respected team and a productive, robust, visible and transparent relationship. Do you believe that you've achieved that objective as yet?
A couple of quick points can be, clearly of course this is not just two governments, this is four governments that we're thinking about in this space. So obviously the Welsh government and the Northern Ireland executive also involved in these things. I think past practice is probably not the best guide to future practice in this space. So as I see with the changes in the devolution settlements, I mean just take maybe two of the most salient examples. If and when further powers over tax and welfare are devolved to the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government, that will intensify the requirement for very close working between the UK Government and the Scottish Government. And so what was practiced in the past in that context is probably not a good guide as to what practice should look like in the future in terms of the visibility, the understanding of the way in which those relationships operate and how they deliver value and how indeed the operators in that space are held to account by their respective parliaments.
But you do see that there is a concern, you know, expressed in the committee's report, you know, that at this stage when we're starting these engagements, we're establishing practice and precedent and whatever, you know, and if it's not already established, and that has not, by your current remarks, considered in any real way how we would involve those parliaments, those parliamentarians and their committee structures about how, you know, not to be involved in the talks, not even to be having public hearings, but knowing that the talks are taking place, aware of the broad agendas and the issues, the people who are giving evidence and the people you're engaging with. There is none of that happening at all now. So that, you know, that gives us, as parliamentarians, we're not going to take the pessimistic example of, we're not going to make ourselves redundant. I don't think that's going to happen. But, you know, you haven't given an indication yet in your answers that you've given any real consideration about how you play these parliaments and parliamentarians in.
So
you may do something in the future.
Yeah. To be clear, nothing's... You're talking about input into the process of consideration.
I'm talking about even being aware of the number of meetings that you and your officials attend, about the number of calls that they make, the issues that they're dealing with, the agendas that are being discussed, and the issues that are being discussed, the basic information we're talking about here.
So, if I may respond to that, Convener, clearly... there has been and will continue to be a good deal of input from parliamentary committees, and indeed the fact that we're here today shows obviously that we are, you know, very alive to the input from the parliamentary context. And that has been picked up by many of the other commentators in this domain. How do we make sure over time that intergovernmental relations, the interface between that parliamentary scrutiny is appropriate? Obviously, we're at the moment engaged in a process of discussion at official level. We've been asked to do that by our politicians through the JMC, and that process has to make its way forward. I don't think it would be appropriate to have that negotiation, if you like, in public space. I think we do need that that space to have that discussion. But ultimately, it is our job not to make the decisions about what happens here, but to advise our politicians on how they may take this forward. And I think the decisions, therefore, on ultimately on the structures for the JMC, the review of the MOU on intergovernmental relations more generally, will be for the JMC itself. And we're preparing the way for that. We are not, in a sense, delivering the outcomes at official level.
Maybe parliamentarians will be given some consideration about how that should go forward, but up until now, we haven't been, you know, been asked to be involved at all in that process. Ken Thomson, do you want to add anything to that before we go to more open questions?
Not to repeat what Philip has already said, but I think just on your last point, Deputy Convener, just to distinguish between the work that Philip described that's putting the JMC in a position to take decisions on this, that's one strand of this. The other strand, I think, is the actual work of intergovernmental relations day to day. And as Philip said, a lot of that happens in a fairly informal way in contacts day-to-day between officials. So that's part of the work of government, and therefore it's open to scrutiny by our respective parliaments. So we're accountable to our ministers and they to their parliaments, including in the case of the Scottish ministers to you. So there is the opportunity, I think, there for committees of the parliament to scrutinise the work of that governments do between governments as well as within governments through all the many ways in which that can be done, including hearings such as this. So I think that there's probably, just as the work of governments is evolving as the devolution settlement evolves, so also I think the nature of parliamentary scrutiny or the content of that scrutiny can also evolve. But I think my point back to you would be that the opportunities for that are already there, or the structures are already there through the accountability of ministers to Parliament.
Stuart Maxwell. Followed by Tavish Scott.
Thank you, Convener. I want to pursue a little more some questions around the memorandum of understanding. Can I ask, in terms of the work that you're doing just now, at what stage are we at in the process, first of all? And is the discussions and work that you're doing, is it likely to revisit the principles of IGR? Could we also see perhaps changes, for example, in the processes that are currently undertaken with regard to intergovernmental relations? Could you just give us some detail around where we are at the moment and what exactly it is you're looking at?
Yes. So the MOU in its current form still largely reflects the document that was drawn up actually before devolution happened. So to that extent, we now have the advantage doing this review of all those years of experience of actually working between governments. It remains a live document and a live set of processes, so we're not writing something in the abstract from either the past experience or current issues. I think we now have a pretty good idea of how the principles that are in the MOU operate in practice and how they need to operate. So mutual respect between governments, good communications, how we resolve disputes and so on. Like Philip, I don't want to give a running commentary on a discussion that ministers haven't yet engaged in themselves, given that the JMC plenary hasn't happened. But I think, broadly speaking, from the fact that ministers in both governments, or all governments, have continued to evolve and adapt the MOU in its current form, you could take it that they agree with the principles that are in there. I think what we're largely doing is seeing how can those principles be
reinforced for the changing nature of the devolution settlement, some of which will be quadrilateral for the four governments, but increasingly a lot of it will be bilateral because of the particular nature of the changes that are coming on tax, already coming on tax, and may well come on welfare. So I don't think that there's a lot of disagreement. In fact, there's a lot of consensus about the principles set out in the MOU. What we have the opportunity to do is look at the detail of how that works in the light of experience and looking ahead to the changes that are going to come on tax and welfare in particular.
So you're effectively saying to me, I think, that you're not re-examining the principles of the IGR in the MOU that's currently in operation. You're looking more at the processes.
We're looking at both. You'd expect us, as part of a review, to look at the whole of how this works. Maybe I can make the same point in a slightly different way, that there's the culture of intergovernmental working and there's the processes and rules, and both matter. And the significance of the rules and the principles in the MOU is not just that they govern the work of JMC committees, but also that they set the framework and the tone for the way that governments interact day-to-day on a whole range of things. And broadly speaking, when I'm describing to my colleagues how I think that should work, what I say is that it's important for governments to understand each other's positions even when they don't agree on them. And that basically underpins the nature of intergovernmental working.
If I may add to that, we have looked at, obviously, starting point for this is thinking about the principles that underpin intergovernmental relations. In a sense, it's credit to the framers of those principles in the first instance that they have stood the test of time. And as Ken has said, I think those principles have worked well. And obviously, again, we will be putting in advice to our ministers on what we think of them now, but the focus has to move on from the principles. How do we make sure intergovernmental relations work and work effectively? And again, it's worth just being aware in that context, the JMC is a political forum. It's a forum for political discussion between governments who will not always agree on a way forward. Our job is to give advice to ministers individually and ultimately collectively on how we think we can adjust those processes in order to ensure that intergovernmental relations remains effective in the light of the change in devolution settlements. But that does encompass principles, but clearly also encompasses process and practice.
You know, I'll try and wrap up my two questions in one to try and speed things along. My first question, then, effectively, is there's been discussion about whether or not the MOU should go on a statutory footing. Effectively, it's legally non-binding at the moment. I just wonder whether there's any discussion going on about that, not on the basis that effectively this would create inflexibility in the system, but in order that, as you probably heard some of the discussions, it would help to create transparency and legitimacy to the process. And I just wondered if you think there are any barriers to putting the MOU on that kind of, and its procedures on that kind of statutory footing. And the second question is, I wonder how, if you could explain to us how it operates. And does it operate on the fact that the governments, all those involved in the process, operate on the basis of an equal footing, mutual respect and trust, or is it on a hierarchical basis?
I'll try and give you a brief combined answer. The JMC operates by consensus, so there's no sort of casting vote, if you like. And on embedding it in statute, the current MOU isn't a piece of legislation. You've heard us both saying that, broadly speaking, we think that has served the four governments reasonably well over the period of devolution. There are some statutory aspects to the way that the two governments, in the case of Scotland and the UK, relate, set out in the Scotland Act. I don't want to speak for my ministers, but so far I think experience shows that it's been possible to promote good intergovernmental working, resolve disputes where they arise, and make clear what's happening without having to put the whole process onto a statutory footing, which I think we'd probably change the character of it and make it a bit less flexible and a bit more, if I imagine, it's a political forum, as Philip said, and political issues tend to get resolved by politicians rather than by judges, would be my reflection on that.
You have the slight advantage on us. Obviously, you've had quite a long debate about with other jurisdictions where intergovernmental relations is on different footings. Clearly, across the table you were talking to earlier on, not on a like basis. They all vary in their ways. We've had a look at practice around the world. I don't think we've spotted a very strong correlation between the extent to which intergovernment relations is tied down in statute and its effectiveness. I think ultimately it does come down, if you like, to the political will that imbues the way in which intergovernmental relations operate. So we're aware that there has been, there's a little bit of opinion expressed from those who've been looking at intergovernmental relations, proposing that it is put on a statutory footing, and that's something that we will have to advise our ministers on, and that's what we will do. But as I say, at the moment, we're not seeing the evidence very strongly that in the UK context in particular, that that would necessarily add to the effectiveness of the processes that we've got. I should pick up also your point about respect and mutual respect. The Prime Minister has been very clear on his agenda of respect, and that is something that informs the approach we take to intergovernmental relations. The process that we're running together, I think, reflects that. When I say together with our colleagues from the Welsh Government and Northern Ireland Executive, this is a process which will move forward by consensus, recognising that respect between the administrations.
Tavi Scott, followed by Linda Fabian.
Thank you very much, Convener. I totally accept your point, gentlemen, that IGR and how it evolves must be in a space that allows that to happen. But as the Convener, I think, pushed you on, this is as much about parliamentary scrutiny of that process, not of what's happening in the nuts and bolts of a negotiation, but how parliaments, both in Cardiff and in Edinburgh, and for that matter, London, as it were, keep an eye on that. And so could I try two examples? Obviously, the current, both in Edinburgh and in London, there's a lot of government activity around the refugee crisis in Europe at the moment. Was that subject to a JMC process, or has that all happened so quickly, as we were hearing earlier on from Germany, that it was just done by ministerial phone calls and so on and so forth? And the second one, which would be more akin to the discussions that Linda and I had in the Smith Commission, when we discussed the month-by-month Agriculture Council, for example, where there's just recently been a European agreement on 500 million euros described as the Hogan package. Now, that would have been subject to a discussion between, I am going to ask you, between agriculture ministers across the UK. But again, parliamentary scrutiny of that. Now, you might well say, Mr. Thomson, you'd be right to say this. Well, I can table parliamentary questions and I can ask Richard Lockhead at question time and so on and so forth. But no committee, including Mr. Gibbs's one, has yet had a chance to have a precise look at that. So that's a long way of saying I don't think we're there yet in terms of parliamentary scrutiny of what currently exists, never mind what happens after the Scotland Bill becomes law.
So to respond briefly, then Philip might want to come in. So there are two issues there. One is when events move fast, and the other is how do parliaments scrutinise the outcome of a process of intergovernmental discussion. So on the first, I should say by way of preface that I couldn't speak to the detail of either of your specific examples, but to give you a general answer of how these things work, informed by my knowledge of those two issues. When something blows up fast, then the nature of the relationship between the two governments is that the officials and ministers know each other, that you can lift the phone. It's possible to have those conversations. I'm sure that people on both sides would think that sometimes they're more effective, sometimes they're less effective. But when I think over experience such as the refugee issue, such as outbreaks of swine flu, or a very good example, the Glasgow airport bombing, that in each of those cases, which I was more directly involved in, there was very good intergovernmental contact and communication and cooperation on a fast-moving issue. So that's it by way of illustration, that this doesn't all go through the formal process of a JMC plenary that meets once a year. On your example from a European negotiation, again, I wasn't directly involved in the lead-up to the particular negotiation that you're describing, but in general, the JMC Europe Committee is the place in which ministers from the four administrations come together to discuss and agree the UK line, which is then developed and delivered in discussions or negotiations in Brussels. So that's the process and the structure which allows the governments to work together on an issue of that kind. And again, I'm sure there will be occasions when the four governments find that process more or less successful or helpful. But it exists, and it's worth noting that even when the JMC plenary went into abeyance for a time, the JMC Europe Committee remained functioning, and that when things get used, that shows you that there's a use for them. And finally, on your point about parliamentary scrutiny of this, I think I'd repeat what I said earlier, that if you regard this as not different in some way, but simply part of the work of governments, then it's possible for parliaments to scrutinise it in the way that parliaments scrutinise the work of governments generally. It's maybe one reflection is that perhaps it's not so clear to parliamentary committees, which tend to have a portfolio focus, where intergovernmental relations would sit. And it's interesting that you're having this discussion and inviting us to give evidence, because this committee does have that kind of by its nature, it has that focus. It might also, just speculating, be something that the conveners group would ask the First Minister about, given that it's an important part of her work as First Minister to relate to the other governments within the UK. So I think the mechanisms are there, but I think there is scope for them, for their use to evolve as the bandwidth in this relationship gets bigger with the changes to the devolution settlement.
Not a huge amount to add to that. Again, like Ken, there are two distinct issues here. The effective working of intergovernmental relations on a day-to-day basis, particularly when under pressure of time, as with the refugee crisis, and an agriculture council that was dealing with what was deemed to be a bit of a crisis situation in agriculture. Certainly from the council perspective, obviously the JMCE operates, tends to meet before the big European councils, but if you go into agriculture fisheries space, there is always a procedure of consultation between the four administrations in the advance of councils, where they discuss the UK line, put that together. It's quite an elaborate procedure, well honed now over time, and works pretty effectively. Obviously, as Ken has indicated, there isn't always 100% agreement, but the process is there to seek to reach agreement. My assumption is that would have operated in this case. Some things do move very fast, and sometimes there is a bit of a disjuncture in the system, particularly if an issue is blowing up in a part of the system where they don't have the habit of interaction. My colleagues on the agriculture and fisheries side, they're used to dealing with this because of the very close intersection of the devolved and the reserve settlements in agriculture and fisheries space. But in other parts of the system, both here and in the south, people won't have that habit of working so closely together. So one of the things that Ken and I and colleagues are having to think through is the more we could do through our auspices of those who are charged with responsibility for thinking about intergovernmental relations generally, is the more we can do at official level to step in and to support the respective governments to get through those difficult moments if that's required. And I think that's one of the things that we need to think about. In terms of parliamentary accountability, I would make the distinction between, if you like, the accountability on day-to-day business, where one of the very legitimate questions to ask is, was that piece of business transacted in a way which demonstrated effective working between the governments? And if that is not demonstrated, that is drawn out. So that is normal business, and all the mechanisms that you have at your disposal and in the Westminster Parliament to hold the governments to account. But there is a separate issue about, if you like, the accountability for IGR in the round. In a sense, that brings it more into our domain, and how do we make sure that, in essence, that the visibility of intergovernmental relations is such, both to parliaments but also to a broader public, that people can effectively hold us to account. I think that's one of the things that we need to think through and put advice to our respective ministers on.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. Hi. I think to add on to what's gone before, I think everyone in this committee recognises that intergovernmental relations go on day to day and deal with things as they come up. However, we do have the Memorandum of Understanding, which is being reviewed at the moment, and within that we have the Joint Ministerial Committees, which is very much set structures of intergovernmental relations. and it's the part that people are then able to look at and see where their respective governmental ministers come together to discuss and promote joint working. Now, I feel very strongly that in order to really do a review that's meaningful, we have to be very honest about what's gone before. And I have to say, Mr. Rycroft, you know, the comment that the joint ministerial committees have served well over the years, I find quite astounding. I suppose it depends on the perspective that you come from and who you think has been served and whose interests should be served. But, you know, for the first 8 years of this Parliament, the joint ministerial committees hardly met at all, apart from the Europe one. And I have to tell you from my own experience, when I went as a minister to a Europe joint ministerial committee, Scotland was under any other competent business. So this was not serving Scotland well in any way at all. So I don't particularly want to go over that old ground. All I'm saying is that there's fine words spoken about mutual respect and parity of esteem. And if this is the right time to be looking at these things over again, let's be very honest about where we've come from and where it has evolved over the years. It used to be this Parliament had to ask parliamentary questions to even find out when joint ministerial committees were being held. Why shouldn't our Parliament and a particular committee know when things are on the agenda for discussion and at least have some kind of report back from it? Now, as I say, this is not to beat anybody up. I'm just talking about the facts. So, you know, let's be very clear where we start from, how we've evolved, and what we're trying to achieve from now. And I hope we can do that.
Mr. Rycroft.
I'm not sure there was a precise question in there. The comment directed at me about the way that things have worked in the past. And clearly, you know, looked at from the broader review of intergovernmental relations, if you look at the way in which the MOU and the JMC supported that, of course, can always find examples of where things have gone wrong, and you can have a view of the overall prospectus here, which is not favourable to it. But in the main, intergovernmental relations have functioned. The number of formal disputes that have come through the system, for example, has been relatively small, only four, to my knowledge, over the last few years, and those have been resolved. One took a little bit of time, but it was resolved relatively rapidly. But the point is, I think as you're at the point you're making, whatever the past, we are at a junction now where we have to look forward, and we can learn from where, if there are issues that people have been concerned about parliamentary scrutiny, about transparency, that's where, you know, in terms of informing our work, we need that input, and indeed we've had a lot of that input. Again, it will ultimately be for ministers to decide how they reflect that in the structures and the new ways of working that they agree if they do so. And that is part of our job, informed by the deliberations of this committee and others as well.
Thank you. Can I ask one other question, please? I forgot about Mr. Johnson.
Yeah,
I just wanted to say two things, reflecting on what you said and the experience of being at some of these committees myself. I mean, I wouldn't want us to give you the impression that these are never frustrating occasions. These are meetings where politicians come together who sometimes have very strong differences of view. And you know from your own experience that can be frustrating, and I'm sure that others have felt the same. But I think what we're saying is that when there is a need to, when there are those disagreements, the JMC process, broadly speaking, recently has provided the forum in which those issues can be aired. I want to go back to your point about the JMC. For some years, the JMC plenary fell into abeyance. I think I recall from an earlier evidence session discussing this with you and making the point then that up until 2007, in the period from 1999 to 2007, there was always a political party, a Labour Party, in power both in Westminster and in Holyrood, here in coalition. And some of the discussions that we're talking about then went through party political channels.
And there was a significant moment of evolution in the practice of intergovernmental relations in 2007 when there was no longer that same colour in power in both places, which actually I think strengthened the operation or caused the operation of formal intergovernmental machinery to have to strengthen because the other channels weren't there. And broadly speaking, I think that has been a good development in that whatever the other channels there are, it's important to have channels in which the two governments engage directly as governments. Mm-hmm. So, it's not been a uniformly similar experience in that whole period, and it's always with its frustrations, but broadly speaking, it does provide the forum in which politicians can get together to try to work out the answer to the differences or at least understand each other.
Yeah, I think that brings us back to the point, Convener, that it is the structure that is there, that people, parliaments and people know that these meetings are taking place. Mm. So it's very important that there's an allowable degree mm-hmm. of transparency yeah. around them. Just to move on from that, something that our panel members raised and other academics at an event last night raised was about the importance of discussion amongst the devolved legislators. And that's I'm not sure there's anything formal about that has been set up in recent years. I know it wasn't there before. There were obviously informal discussion around JMCs, etc., and various, like the British Irish Council of the Isles, stuff like that. But is that something you're looking at under the MOU?
We caught Dr. Mueller's answer to you that that's a yes. political question and you're the politicians. We quite like that answer. to give you a serious answer, I think the focus of our work is on supporting our ministers in how they decide how government should relate. There's clearly a set of issues for parliaments about how they relate, but I think we'd be exceeding our brief if we advised parliaments on that. You have your own sources of advice.
Earlier, you suggested that that's something that parliamentarians need to look at seriously about, you know, to fulfil that responsibility and to ensure that we are using all the mechanisms yeah. that are available to us in a new situation. Yeah. I think you did exactly. refer to that earlier.
Maybe just to add yeah. briefly to that, of course, it was one of the things that came out of the Smith Commission proposals, the sort of bilateral relations between parliaments or trilateral, quadrilateral. And clearly that is space for the parliaments to take forward. I mean, anything we can do to facilitate that, very happy to do it, but it's not our place to lead on that yeah. work.
It's something we can reflect on, I think, in terms of... Malcolm?
I'm interested in dispute resolution. I think Philip Rycroft referred to four instances where the protocol, I presume, had been invoked, but we don't know how that works. Could you say something about what happens when there is a dispute in that way?
I can say briefly about it. Certainly, there is a process set out in the MOU. This is part, if you like, of the consensual workings of the JMC, that if one of the administrations feels aggrieved about a particular issue, it has the ability to invoke the dispute avoidance and resolution procedures, and then there is a whole set of procedures to go through to escalate that as necessary. I think I'd make two points about this, I think, in general terms. One is, in a way, the clue is in the title to that relevant section of the MOU, dispute avoidance and resolution. And a lot of the work we're doing is informed by, I think, the collective wish of governments to avoid disputes where possible. And how do you avoid disputes? You avoid disputes between good working relationships, between good respectful working relationships, between early discussion about issues that might come in up, so that there is the time and the space to try and resolve issues before they get to the point of formal disagreement or formal dispute. I think the second point I'd make, and a lot of people are looking at dispute resolution, clearly one of the things that's on our agenda, and asking whether they should dispute resolution should be made more formal. It's a bit the other side of the you're making the whole process statutory. I think in that, clearly this again is something we're going to have to look at, and look at quite hard. I think the point I'd make at this stage is, as with the wider machinery, this is an intrinsically political process. And the more formal you make dispute resolution, the risk is you begin to constrain, if you like, the scope for political intervention to resolve something. And if I could refer to the Deputy First Minister's discussion of this when he was at this committee earlier in June, I think, talking about the dispute around the Olympic Barnet consequentials. And he was saying it took an awfully long time for that to be resolved, which is true, but he also said the resolution came when there was political will to make that resolution. And I think that is a very important point, that in looking at dispute resolution, we don't overly constrain the capacity of the politicians to find the resolutions to the issues that arise.
We're all thinking about at the moment is the fiscal framework. So would that go through the joint ministerial committee? I mean, there's been suggestions that there should be some, if there isn't agreement, some independent arbitration around that. I presume that would be resisted by the UK government, maybe not by the Scottish government. I don't know. What do you think about that?
So the fiscal framework falls very squarely into bilateral space, and this will be a bilateral relationship between the UK government and the Scottish government. This, as you are well aware, is negotiation in process at the moment. And again, you've had the opportunity to speak to the Deputy First Minister about it some weeks ago now, but that negotiation, that process continues. But as with fiscal relationships clearly there needs to be an ongoing relationship between particularly the Treasury and the Scottish Government to manage those issues on an annual as well as a multi-annual basis. All of that becomes more complex if we get to the stage of further devolution, particularly through the further devolution of tax and welfare powers. And that is something, how that is managed once we get to that point is something that will have to be looked at in the context of the fiscal framework negotiation. So again, I'm not at liberty, if you like, to lift a veil on that. But how are those processes managed effectively on a year-to-year basis, including dealing with any issues that may come up between the two administrations, is absolutely something that will have to be dealt with in that context.
The process of agreeing the fiscal framework, if there isn't agreement between the governments, will the process you described just be invoked and it will be through the Joint Ministerial Committee, or will there be any other way of resolving that?
I can't give you an answer to that question because that clearly is something that is being discussed in a separate forum between the two governments, and you know, they'll have to work out in that context how effectively to manage issues around the fiscal framework. The only point I would make in that is ultimately, clearly, as I say, these are political processes, and ultimately the Prime Minister runs the UK government, First Minister running the Scottish government, and they are ultimately, if you like, responsible for the smooth working of relations overall. So how that is expressed formally in the structures will have to be worked through in the course of the discussions around the fiscal framework and indeed intergovernmental relations more generally.
Does Ken Thomson want to comment on arbitration?
I was going to just respond to your earlier question, then I'll come to arbitration. Philip made the point that the relevant section in the MOU is headed dispute avoidance and resolution, and typically disputes arise for firstly because maybe the right people aren't looking at the issues, so there's a problem of attention. And quite often through the less formal process, including, for example, Philip ringing me up or me ringing him up and saying, we need to make sure that people are looking at this issue because otherwise it's heading towards a dispute, and that often resolves things. The second thing that the dispute protocol operates to achieve is that people understand each other's positions and where there are shared interests or not. So the way the protocol is written is to get some good work done on that. And then the third is to try to put a timetable around things to make sure that things don't drift. And the timescales are set out there. They're not binding. And in the case of the Olympics dispute, it did take longer than the timescale set out there, but a solution was eventually found. All of that is by way of saying that I don't think anybody's in doubt that the fiscal framework is receiving attention and is getting good work done on it, and there's a very clear timetable set out for that in the way that the Deputy First Minister has commented about the importance of the fiscal framework outcome for the his advice to the Parliament on the legislative consent motion on the Scotland Bill. So all of that, not to comment on the substance of that negotiation, but it's certainly getting a lot of attention and hard work at the moment. So as yet, nobody has thought it necessary to invoke the protocol that's in this document. You mentioned arbitration. Protocol was recently amended to include the possibility of independent input. I may be wrong on this, but to the best of my recollection, that hasn't happened in a dispute so far. It's therefore an open question whether that independent element could include arbitration or not. I think, speculating slightly, if the ministers involved in the dispute wanted it to, then it could. That would have to be a decision by consensus. My experience, echoing points Philip has made earlier, is that these are essentially matters of politics, and politicians are good at working out an agreement if there's an agreement to be found, or not doing that if there isn't one to be found. Would arbitration help? There's a range of views on that. I think I commented on that the last time I was in front of you giving evidence, and I think I would say the same thing this time.
That's really interesting about the external input, I think was the phrase you used, because that's obviously not something that... Perhaps, I don't know whether that I should know that. I don't know whether that's is that written in the memorandum.
It's in the memorandum.
Right. Okay. Sorry. Yeah. Well, I hadn't seen that. Well, yeah. That's really interesting because I suppose my final observation would be that all the issues you've described are very micro by comparison with the fiscal framework. So it may well be that some external input might be useful if there are problems with that.
If I gave you one further example, the Edinburgh Agreement, which nobody would describe as a micro agreement, was reached by a negotiation between the two governments, essentially similar to the one that's happening at the moment on the fiscal framework, and that it wasn't found necessary by either of the two governments to invoke the dispute resolution procedure because we did actually reach an agreement through the ordinary course of intergovernmental working. So we're not at the point on the fiscal framework of it being a formal dispute. We're in a negotiation, and that's pretty normal.
Okay.
If there's no other members, I've got just to try and complete a range of our questions. No other members. Just referring back to, I think, Mr. Rycroft, you mentioned that you did some comparative work about intergovernmental agreements across other jurisdictions, and you will have found that in some countries, intergovernmental agreements are subject to the consent of Parliament, and sometimes there's an opportunity to suggest amendments to those agreements. And indeed, I suppose the linkage to that is the legislative consent motions that we deal here. So there's a broad mechanism, that we do use already. And given that we will be dealing with more and more shared powers in terms of welfare and taxation, have you considered in your discussions that there may be a case for extending the role of Parliament and giving consent to intergovernmental agreements?
Certainly the whole parliamentary nexus is something that we are having to consider. It is points that have been raised by this committee, by Smith and by numerous others. So how do we manage that relationship between the processes of intergovernmental relations and parliamentary procedures is something very much within our purview. I think the question of if you like, a formal involvement, my guess is that where you're seeing parliaments able to make, if you like, proposals for formal amendments to procedures, is where those procedures in themselves are bound into statute. So I think those two things would be hooked together. If we don't end up in statutory space, that requires, therefore, a rather different relationship with the input from the parliaments over time. I think the point I'd make on this is we're working this in real time. Obviously, the legislation that is changing the settlements is still going through Parliament, and in some cases is still to be introduced to Parliament. And experience of the new settlements will develop once they're implemented, if they're implemented, and as they move forward. And I think that takes us into, if you like, the dynamic relationship between parliamentary accountability the opinions of parliaments individually and collectively about how this process is working, and the input of that into governments, and how governments are held to account, and therefore how intergovernmental relations evolves and develops over time. You'll have noticed that the MOU itself, the MOU that we have at the moment, has been amended and revised several times over the last few years, which reflects, if you like, the dynamic of the of intergovernmental relations under the current settlements. So I think the point I'd make on this in terms of parliamentary input on this, it doesn't seem to me that one should restrict oneself to looking at a fixed point for parliamentary input, but to see that as part of the process of scrutiny of accountability, and that proposals and suggestions for improving intergovernmental relations from the parliaments should be something that have been put to governments as this develops and as we get more experience of intergovernmental relations in the context of the new devolution settlements.
Just broadly to agree with what Philip said, I think it echoes my earlier point that this is part of the work of governments, and therefore it's open to the parliaments to scrutinise that, and that could perhaps feature in the scrutiny that individual committees make of ministers and civil servants to ask the question, for example, on the refugee crisis, how good was the intergovernmental working between the two governments on that issue? So that, I think the mechanisms for scrutiny are there, and the practice and the use of those will evolve as the settlement evolves.
Will there then be an opportunity for this parliament and other parliaments to see a draft of the revised memorandum of understanding before sign-off?
I think that would be a question for our ministers, but we'll have the opportunity to take that point back to them.
Well, I suppose then the next question and final question is, would you welcome proposals from this committee and Parliament into your review process on a formal evidence basis?
Certainly, one of the things that we've been very conscious of is the input from a number of sources over the last few months, including parliamentary ones, including some consideration of this committee already, obviously the Smith Commission process, the Silk Commission process had words on this. I mentioned earlier on the Lords Constitution Committee, the House of Commons Political Constitutional Reform Committee, quite a lot of the academic community that interests itself in this area has offered their wisdom as well. So there is a rich evidence base here, but you, I think, have an advantage of coming into this with your current inquiry when the broad structure of the evolving devolution settlements are becoming clearer. Speaking on a personal point of view, certainly the fruits of your discussions, I think, would be enormously helpful to inform our work as we move it forward. And we haven't reached any conclusions yet, so our door is open and hopefully our minds are open to for any input you would wish to make.
I think we'll take that as a yes.
Good.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your attendance here this morning and the session that we had. As previously agreed, I think now we go into a private session. I'll give a few moments for our witnesses to leave, and we'll make progress there. And I might even get a coffee and a pastry.